gunde lo hande gunde e 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 namwi e hande he 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 e namwi e
hande gunde e makalade gunde mazembe zimu.
He said, I am here because here is where my fields are, here is where I fish, here is what I have, what I need. We cultivate many different products on our fields, and sometimes we are able to sell the surplus and we are then able to buy the things that we need for our children. I want to call your attention to one fruit that we cultivate. It's called Mazanica, and it's very doubtful that we are able, that we would be able to cultivate this fruit in any other place. What we need to make sure is that if we have to move, that we will be compensated for everything that we have here, that we will have the same benefits that we have now in our current life. We really would like to know when we have to move, where we have to move to, and to ensure that the conditions are at least as good as what we have in our present conditions.
It's projected to be around 100 meters high, and it will be just around the Mpandoko mountain there, linking it to the other bank.
Generate income in this community is through fishing. We have fishing nets and we are able to sell the fish, some of the fish, and then we are able to sell the straw mats that we are able to weave. All this produces income, and this income cannot be lost. Having access to this cash income is what helps reduce poverty.
The residential man says that he's 6 children and 15 grandchildren. He has lived with his wife for the past 40 years. And here in this place they've been for the last 9 years. And life is going very well here because he has a canoe, he catches a lot of fish, and sometimes his canoe is rented out to others who have fishing nets, and it's all means extra income. In addition, there's sugar cane that he grows, and again, this is a source of income.
So she says her name is Narcisa Sabonete, and she is a founder member of the Vozes do Zambeze. She says that Mpandankua Dam will bring negative impacts, especially to the women. They will be the most affected group of the communities downstream.
That this is the kind of product that grows here very well. We don't know where we will be living next. We have no idea to where they will send us. Yes, one of the ladies said that she's very worried because when they leave here, they will need a lot of things. They will need a field, they will need a house, they will need other things. And what about, for instance, those women who don't have husbands? You know, the husbands are needed to first, you know, create the field. So they're very worried about what will happen once the dam is built. We don't really know what's going to happen. It's, you know, we have 1 foot up and 1 foot down. We don't really know. We are hanging in the air somewhere. We don't really know.
The campaign started in 2002 when we were in the field where the proposed Mpandankua Dam is going to be constructed, and realized there was a lack of information from the communities that had no idea what was going on. And also there was a lack of information. When we were trying to get more information, the documents weren't available. And still today, there's still documents not available. We can't have a full assessment of the project still. And there's very little participation. And there's a lot of risks and concerns that haven't been addressed or answered.
He would like the Mozambican government to take into consideration the community's concerns. And at this moment, what they are saying is that first they want to build the dam, and then they will listen to what the communities are saying. And they say that this will cause big problems. They need the government to listen to what they are saying now and get that into their plans and keep that in consideration all throughout the project.
Yes, the experience from the town of Songo near Kawarabasa was that people were relocated to a place called Kapiri. There, some of the people died right away. Others then tried to return to Songo, but they were not allowed to stay, and they were taken again further and further away to a mountainous area. And there, people continued to suffer, and they continued to suffer until this very day. They have been unable to recover.
Well, we have Kawarabasa, and it's well known throughout Africa as being one of the worst, most destructive dams and least studied dams. Even UN studies have claimed such. And basically, from construction, it was a different era, it was during the colonial time. So the resettlement was, estimates are up to 40,000 people were affected, forcibly removed. The number of people killed was also extremely high, working conditions really bad. So the communities in that area really have had bad experiences. In addition to that, the problems of Kawarabasa are still occurring today. There are unpredictable floods during the dry season to meet energy requirements or navigation by the ferry. In October in 2003, when I was there, you could actually see that suddenly within a few hours the water starts raising and they lost their crops. Their crops were 2 weeks from getting from being harvested, and mostly 80% could have been harvested then if they had warning, but they lost everything just because of lack of warning, and that's during the dry season when there shouldn't be any floods.
The dam cannot be allowed to bring us suffering. There's a lot of previous experience from the Kawarabasa Dam, where people were forcibly resettled to faraway locations, and the people were suffering a great deal because of this, and this suffering continues until this very day.
In the area, there's an estimated 1,400 families based on the 2002 EIA. The problem is those numbers, there's questions around how accurate they are, because some of the local communities have claimed that the numbers vary from up to 6,000 to 10,000 individuals. So there is a bit of questioning on how accurate the number is. The other problem is that there is no settlement plan, detailed settlement plan yet. The government have said that that will be the responsibility of the project donors, and because at the moment it's unclear who's going to be funding it, and so they say it's a later phase, which makes it raise questions on how to at the estimates and how much the project is going to cost if they haven't taken that into account yet. It raises concern about there's another possible area where conflict could occur, because most of the budget has been focused on the most common themes as in the past, which is the construction costs, the power lines, and those the technical costs have been well addressed. However, again, settlement is put as an afterthought, and that can again raise problems as it's been in the past with many dams.
So we have to make very sure that if we indeed have to leave here, that we will receive fair compensation. That you know, we can keep the kind of living that we have here, including schools for our children. And without this being guaranteed, we will not leave here. This gentleman is against the dam. They do not see any kind of benefit that the dam would bring to them. Here, you know, you have these fruits, you know, you have your fields, you are near the river and you can fish. If you have to move away, you don't have this. And then there's the experience from Kawarabasa. The benefits of Kawarabasa all went to far away places. They went to South Africa, they went to Zimbabwe. But local people stayed in their same, you know, stayed in their same old conditions, the same type of houses. They still don't have electricity at home, etc. So it's against the dam because it will not bring the benefits.